actually just got back from London, where I gave a version of this to some really freaked out Londoners. You know, it's very interesting. You know, there's this movement of, you know, what at least in Europe they call this sort of right-wing populism that they're very concerned about. You know, the Brexit, that is Britain leaving the EU. You know, these characters who are, you know, staunchly anti-immigrant type candidates in a lot of different countries, who are getting a lot more traction than those types of parties usually get. And the thing that I found so interesting about Britain was, you know, in America, we don't tend to look at these races outside of the country and think, well, that's going to have a big impact on us. They, however, see what's going on here as having an enormous impact on them, you know, that we're really kind of an agenda setter for what's going to happen in the rest of the world. So it was really fascinating, you know, in that sense. So, you know, my style of giving talks is to be sort of more conversational. You know, I have a bunch of slides and things like that that I'll show during the course of things. I'm going to talk less maybe about the specific election, although we'll talk about how we ended up with specifically Donald Trump and a little bit Hillary Clinton, although her story is a much more conventional one during the course of it. But what I'm really going to try to get to is, you know, what's at the root of our divisions these days? Why do we seem to dislike each other so much in politics? And, you know, you guys, you know, I'm not going to make any judgments, but judging by hair color, you know, some of you all have been around a couple of years and, you know, have experienced, you know, the things that I've experienced too. So you'll know, you know, very well, you know very well, that politics hasn't always been this way. It's very different these days. And, you know, by way of introduction, for me, you know, so first of all, my name is Marc Hetherington. I'm a professor of political science at Vanderbilt. I've been here in Williamson County for the last dozen years. Suzanne, my wife, and I are starting our 13th year here in Middle Tennessee. We have two little boys who are big users of Williamson County stuff, whether it's the Brentwood Library, which is right down the road from us, or any number of other things. One's, a, you know, big into music and the music program at Brentwood High School. The other is, you know, big into athletics at the middle school. But where I come to politics or from to political science is not the usual fuzzy-headed academic route. I actually worked in politics for a couple of years, and the reason I worked in politics for a couple of years is that politics is my dad's life's work. He's now 88. My parents are now a combined 175, which I'm extraordinarily proud of, and also hoping it's predictive of something for me. But beyond that, you know, dad has been a political operative really since the 1950s. And it's, you know, this socialization around the dinner table that I got that, you know, caused me to be interested in studying the things that I study. And, you know, my expertise is on public opinion specifically, so we'll be talking a lot about things that come out of public opinion surveys and election results and things like that. But as it relates to polarization specifically, and a friend and co-author of mine, a fellow named Jonathan Weiler, we're working on a project together, you know, that's designed less for an academic audience and more for, you know, what you'd call a trade audience, a popular audience, where some of the stuff that we're talking about here is pretty germane, pretty relevant. And so in that sense, I'd be really interested to get your input during this. I can talk at you for 45 minutes. That usually is something that at least my students find less attractive. I'm happy to have you interrupt me and ask questions. I'm happy to have you provide your thoughts at any, you know, various point during the course of the presentation. You don't have to wait until the end if something is just, you know, just eating at you to talk about. So anyway, so tell me a little bit about you guys, you know, so that I know. And you, not all of you have to, but just a couple of brave souls, just so that we can break the ice here. Tell me a little bit about you. Yes, sir.
I'm from Scotland, and my family over there is terrified.
Okay. So where in Scotland is okay.
Well, there you go.
This is yeah, but I'm just amazed. And, I'm an American citizen, but I'm still amazed where we are. We're not out there. Wish we could do what we're doing. So dissolve Parliament, and 50 days later we have an election.
Yeah, and as I understand it, you would leave. The Scots would leave Great Britain, but join the the European Union to be connected. Oh, I bet. So have you ever heard of a small town just south of the Scotch border called Carlisle?
Yes.
Well, that's where my family's from. So
as
I understand it, you don't want to stop. You just keep going. There's nothing to stop for.
Yeah, you should go to London, probably.
Exactly. So I was considering during my visit there to stop, and I have a friend who's teaching in Glasgow, and he said, why would you go to Carlisle? So anyway, who else is?
I'm Patricia Armstrong.
Hey, Patricia.
My concern is that people who don't like government run for office so they can destroy government. It never used to be like that.
So it's interesting to me. I have some thoughts on this that are somewhat consistent, but not exactly about destroying government, but something that really worries me. And that is, again, most of the things that I'm going to talk about today and all things are on average. I'm not saying everybody is this way or everybody is that way. But one of the things that I've thought about is, politics for the last 40 years has become a low esteem profession. You don't brag that I'm a politician. It used to be, when we were younger, that you served. You were called to serve, and it was a different approach to governing. But politics, government has taken on such a negative cast. So the thing that concerns me more than anything is, back when it was a service, everybody got involved. Now that it's not a service, now that it's a low status occupation, what are the types of people who do get involved? And the worry that I have is, it's people who love the roar of the crowd, it's people who love the adulation, it's people who are maybe not the most personality-wise fit for this. And this is, my big project in many ways with, the kids that I teach. I face, 150, 200 students, each year. I try to inspire them, to be part of the system. And that's one of the things I'm gonna try to get to towards the end of the talk. Okay, yeah.
Dark money.
Yeah. That's dark.
Absolutely horrified. Yeah. The money,
the misuse
of the 401.
Yeah, the
money is supposed to be for doing great things
instead of subverting. Yeah, the 501c3s and all of this kind of stuff. It's crazy. And here's the one thing that I think is so interesting about all of this dark money. Where did the dark money go during the course of the presidential, the primaries? It mostly went to the sort of establishment Republicans. Who were their opposition research people that they couldn't dig up these things on Donald Trump, that have been leaking out in the last couple of weeks? I mean, what were they spending their hundreds of millions of dollars on? I mean, they really, whoever was providing those services shouldn't have jobs, any longer. And of course, it is just a staggering amount of money. One more question.
And also, I'm working on my undergraduate, finishing my undergraduate degree for a 30-year.
Well, I think that's fantastic.
And writing a culminating project on civil discourse.
Ah.
And
good luck with that.
Media. Yeah, there's not any research on that at all.
Well, no, but I mean, there's no civil discourse. Right now, I mean, that's my worry for you. I mean, it's a great topic, I think, actually. And, maybe one, that can provide a little bit of inspiration.
Next year, Franklin Morrow can help create some civil discourse.
Well, that's fantastic. So what I'm going to try to provide you guys a sense of is, what is it that divides us these days that makes uncivil discourse, such a thing? Now, it's funny, when I give versions of this talk both to audiences that are, from the community, also to students And it's interesting, when I go through these first several slides with students, they don't remember this stuff at all. But what I'm going to show you is a set of pictures starting with 2000. And you know, you might see some similarities between them. You know, there were only three states that changed between 2000 and 2004. 2008, you added a few more blue states as opposed to red states. But of course, we had one of the worst financial crises in the history of the country. So the Republicans, being the in party, didn't do quite as well. And then in 2012, we're, you know, right back to almost exactly the same electoral map. So if you just do some counting, what you see is that 40 of the 50 states have voted exactly the same way in each of the last four elections. 40 of 50, 80%. And way more than 80% of the people in the country live in those 40 states. What this suggests, of course, is that most states are really not in play, even some of the biggest states in the country. You know, you would think that, you know, California and its 50-whatever electoral votes would be a place where people campaign. Of course, they don't have to. Texas is enormous. New York is enormous. We don't campaign there. Why? Because we already know who the winners are going to be. Funny thing about this map is, you know, we actually had an electoral map that once looked almost exactly like this. And not even any of us are old enough to have lived through it. And that is in the late 1800s. The electoral maps from about 1880 to 1896 looked exactly like this, except for the parties were flipped. So as we think about the things that divide us, maybe we want to think about that era, too, to the extent that states are states and the people who live there tend to be, you know, kind of similar. Now, the interesting thing about this map, is these are some of the closest elections that we've had in the history of the country, especially 2000, of course, famously, but also 2004. The last time there was a race as close as 2004 in the Electoral College, at least, was when Woodrow Wilson won his second term. But the funny thing is that even though we're nationally really competitive, on a state-by-state basis, we're not competitive at all, actually. So, you know, I've taken a number of relatively close elections and traced them over time. And up at the top, you see the popular vote margin. I would just like to apologize if my left arm doesn't go up. I went to Flulapalooza today at Vanderbilt, where I got my free flu shot. And I have to say, it hurts. So just to keep you guys in the loop about how my physical well-being is. But you see these really close margins in some of these elections. Jimmy Carter, of course, over Gerald Ford in 76. Kennedy, maybe dubiously, over Nixon in 1960. And the average state margins, about 8 percentage points. There were very few states that you would call blowouts, those being states that were won by 20 percentage points or more. Battleground states with less than 5 percentage points between the candidates, very numerous, 20, 18, lots of battleground states. These are the Electoral College votes that are connected to the blowout states, so 56 and 34, almost, so small states were the blowout states. Battlegrounds, in 1976, you only need 270 to win the presidency, so 299 electoral votes were just in these battleground states. You know, in other words, the big states and most states, or many states, were competitive. But flash forward to 2012, you know, still in the electoral, I mean, in the popular vote, not a big blowout, about 4 percentage points for Obama. It was safe, you know, for him. And in the Electoral College, he did, you know, better than winning by 4. But the average state margin, 17 percentage points. We basically have the same number of blowouts that we used to have battlegrounds and the same number of battlegrounds that we used to have blowouts. So even though we're nationally competitive, state by state we're not. So, you know, we live in Tennessee. Are we going to get the presidential campaign? Have you guys seen a lot of presidential campaign ads? I haven't seen a one during the course of the general election. But if you lived in Bristol, you know, you're connected to Virginia, you'd see them. Why? Because Virginia's a battleground state. It could go either way, and Tennessee is not. So we wonder, you know, what are the nature of these divisions? You know, and the stock explanations that people point to, we often want to think about ourselves in terms of demography, So we have actually bigger racial differences in voting than any time in the history of the country. In all likelihood, in this election, more than three quarters of non-whites will vote Democratic, and probably, who knows now? But until this past weekend, we would have probably expected 60% of whites to vote, not quite 60, but close to 60 to vote Republican. When we talked about racial disparities or racialized voting, we always talked about it in terms of minority groups. But whites are now, seemingly developing kind of a racial identity in their own right, which is fascinating. And it's, again, not just happening in the United States. This is something that's happening, sort of all over the place. Great example of this sort of rural, suburban versus the cities, of course, is here in Nashville. If people talk about states, red states and blue states, you walk out into the parking lot and someone wants to talk with you about red states and blue states, say, that's not the way to think about it. It's actually about population density. It's cities that are blue, and of course lots of people live in cities, and it's suburban and rural areas that are red. So I'm from Pennsylvania originally. James Carville, the hairless political consultant, he describes Pennsylvania, because he cut his teeth in Pennsylvania, that's where he won his first campaign, he describes it as Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, with Alabama in between. I'm from the Alabama part. I married a woman from Alabama. But again, it does give you a sense, it's not the state, it's a blue state, but it's actually, where I'm from, not blue at all, okay? And here in Williamson County, we're red, but if you drive into Nashville, you're pretty blue and getting bluer as time goes by. We have a huge chasm in terms of old and young. This, will work to the Republicans' disadvantage as time goes by. Last I checked, the Grim Reaper gets us all. With that in mind, the youth of the country being Democratic, inspired by Obama's first couple of, or especially his first run for office, may well end up being a big deal. People sometimes, I think, make the mistake that young people are always liberal and always Democratic. I grew up in the 1980s, which was on the heels of the Carter debacle and the Reagan Revolution. My generation is Republican. That's true of the generation before mine, too. And then we have this enormous gender gap, which, this particular campaign seems to be exacerbating. But again, these are all things that you could read in the newspaper. Why would you bother to come and see me if I'm just going to tell you those things? So I'm going to tell you some things that are also kind of interesting about Democrats and Republicans. One of the things is that we eat different things. There's all of this, developing micro-targeting data that has been developed, because everybody buys things with credit cards and with debit cards and things along those lines. So we have a pretty good sense of what their profiles are. There are all these websites, chowhound.com, and one of them starts with an H, I can't remember. But they ask people, questions when they, visit there, including if they're liberal or conservative, Republican or Democrat. Turns out that Democrats like vegetables a lot more than conservatives do. Conservatives like meat a lot more than liberals do. Who knows? Pets. Any ideas on which is the dog party and which is the cat party?
Democrats
are cats. Right. Democrats are, in fact, the cats. Now, it's not that Democrats hate dogs, but, let's say you're out walking the dog, because, we're in Williamson County, so, of course, it's all Republicans, right? So you're out walking the dog. Would you guess that, dog breed might, or dog size might have something to do with it? Or, Democrats might like smaller dogs. Republicans like big, powerful dogs. John Haidt, a friend of mine who's a moral psychologist at NYU, he suggests that actually Democrats seem to want to have like a personal relationship with their animals in a way that conservatives are just not really interested in. So if you're going to find a dog on the furniture, it's going to be at a Democrat's house. If you're going to find a dog sitting obediently by the bed, on average, it's going to be, you know, at a conservative's house. Computers, everybody uses PCs, but conservatives use them more than liberals do. Liberals like Macs. There's that. And you know, if we lucked out into the parking lot here and ran across a Toyota Prius, are we making any judgments about what that person's politics is like? Maybe. What if it was a GMC Yukon? Yeah, we might make some determinations about that person's politics too. And in fact, it's true. Conservatives tend to like American cars. They stick with the same brands over time, whereas liberals tend to like foreign cars that are smaller. Of course, part of this is driven by where they live. But what I'm trying to get at here is not anything other than we're wired differently. Our tastes are different. It's not even just that we differ about politics. There are these things that are underlying our physiologies, our biologies, our personalities that cause us not to be able to really necessarily understand each other in ways that back when politics was drawn along different lines, when some of the issues that are important these days weren't important, we didn't create these divisions. So again, just to give you a sense of it, any idea, is this a Democratic dog or a Republican dog? Well, so what are some of the markers? I mean, so first of all, he's small. He's on the furniture. He's on the furniture, and he looks vaguely drunk. A liberal, juicing him up at that point. But again, you know, this is sort of my point. Let's say you're out, taking a walk or driving your car, and you go past somebody who has a dog like that. Now we're making determinations about that person politically in a way that we probably didn't used to in the past. You know, what their t-shirt says. Do they have a Duck Dynasty t-shirt on, or do they have a t-shirt from a rap group? That line works much better with the kids. Turns out that we watch different TV shows. So it's a little bit fuzzy. This particular thing is a little bit dated. The Republican shows are the ones on the left. Do you see, you guys, I've learned that kids don't watch shows. They stream. So you guys might be a better audience for this. Do you see a pattern in the Republican shows? What thing seems to unify at least some of these shows?
Family.
I'm sorry?
Family.
So family could be part of these. Yeah, though Modern Family is a little surprising in certain respects. Any other things? How about reality shows? There are a lot of reality shows on there. You have Amazing Race, American Idol, Dancing with the Stars, and so forth. Another thing is that almost all of them are on network TV as opposed to on cable, which is interesting. Now let's take a look at the Democratic shows, ones that's very Democratic. Do you see any patterns to hear? Any things that stand out? A lot of them. So a lot of cable shows, Mad Men was what, AMC, and Dexter is HBO. God knows what Courtney and Chloe Take Miami is. But a lot of those things. A lot of quirky characters, a lot of weird people. If you watch 30 Rock, that's the show that, the very neurotic Tina Fey is the main character on. Mad Men was one of my favorite shows before it went off the air. There's nobody on Mad Men who you actually like root for. They're all broken, in certain respects. Seriously, except for maybe Peggy. The fact of the matter is, the Democrats seem to like quirky characters, who are non-mainstream, sorts of people who they're complicated. Dexter is a serial killer, doesn't get any less mainstream than that. Turns out we watch different sports. This is all going to be a little bit too small, probably. But the Republican sports are in red. The Democratic sports are in blue. Not surprisingly, maybe, given stereotypes, the PGA Tour is the place where you see both high turnout and Republicans. Strangely, I'm not sure why, but low turnout Democrats, like the WWE, the pro wrestling, I don't have anything there. But you know, the Democrats seem to like these sort of niche-y, weird, you know, kind of niche sports like the WNBA that nobody watches, women's tennis, and women's sports, Major League Soccer. Soccer is something that Fox sometimes around World Cup time describes as un-American. So the Democrats are over there, and the more, you know, kind of traditional college football, everybody watches the NFL, but it's slightly skews Republican. But anyway, the basic idea is we're not doing the same things. We're, you know, we're finding different types of things compelling. So this starts to get us to some research that suggests that maybe some of these differences are deep down actually inside of us. And I won't go through all of these different things, but I do find them pretty darn fascinating. So when I talk about eye tests, one of them is an eye tracking test. And again, these are not given to random samples of Americans. They're given to subjects in a lab, usually in the hundreds, not in the thousands, and usually around a college town as opposed to someplace else. But they, you know, advertise in the community, pay people a certain number of dollars, they come in and they take a test. And they also fill out a survey. And among the survey questions are questions about, you know, their politics, their ideology, their party, and things along those lines. So when I talk about the eye tracking tests, they put eye trackers on people, and they give them a palette of objects to look at. Some of them are dangerous, and some of them are like beach balls. And it turns out that the conservatives, people who identify themselves as conservative, dwell much longer on the dangerous things than on the beach balls. Liberals also dwell on the dangerous things because we're human beings, you know, we're wired to be wary. But conservatives are warier than liberals are. Startle reflex, this is an interesting one. So what they do is they put a different eye thing on you. It counts blink amplitude, you know, so how quick your eyes blink. And they put headphones on you, and then at a random time, they blow white noise into it. They're boop, and you know, of course, it scares the heck out of you. And they count how many times your eyes blink. And the blink amplitude, the more you blink, the more startleable you are. Turns out the conservatives startle more than liberals do. Gag reflex. You secrete an enzyme when you're really disgusted, you know, when you're really grossed out. And they put these skin conductivity things on your fingers. And they show people disgusting images. And I don't mean political images. What I mean is pictures of really gross things, like a disgusting toilet. Actually, there's one of a man eating worms. I mean, you know, things that are, yeah, I know, I feel the same way. The interesting thing is, you know, there are all these rules in academia on research practice, and the people who make judgments about what you can do is called the IRB. And actually, I know the guy who did, you know, this work on gag reflex. His name is John Hibbing, and John said that IRB refused to show a picture of that unless he was the person who was eating the worm. So the picture is of John eating worms, which he said was awful. But in any case, it turns out that Republicans secrete more of this enzyme that suggests disgust than conservatives do more than liberals. And as it relates to personality, it turns out that, and this has been something that we've had a better sense of for a little bit longer, but people who are conservative and liberal differ on two of what we call the big five personality characteristics. They're sort of five factors of personality. One of them is called openness to experience, which is, you know, relatively obvious. You know, you score high in openness to experience. It means you want to try new things out. You know, you're open to all sorts of different things. Liberals score high in that. Conservatives score lower. And conscientiousness. Conscientiousness is something, you know, that suggests a person is tradition-oriented, a person is, like, if who's going to be on time for a meeting? or something along those lines. Well, seriously, let me ask you, in your lives, if somebody is going to be late for a meeting, is it going to be a conservative or is it going to be a liberal? Hey, a liberal's going to be late, man. The conservative's going to show up on time. And there are all these things, you know, along these lines that seem to, you know, kind of connect with this conscientiousness. If you go into the kids' dorm rooms, you'll find the liberals' rooms are more of a mess. Conservatives are more more likely to have things like ironing boards and calendars and, you know, things that organize. Yeah. Yes. Yes. Well, this is, so we're not going to, okay, so the question was, you know, so we have the notion of conscientiousness versus openness to experience. It's the people on the political right who are conscientious, the people on the political left who are open to experience. And the question is a good one: who gets the work done? And I think that the answer to that question is in different kind of work, you know. So you know, when we think about the Silicon Valley, you know, we think about people who are extraordinarily creative and things along those lines. They probably score really high in openness. They may not show up for a meeting, you know, on time, and they get certain things done. But they would be terrible bank managers, or probably managers of just about any sort. They're messy. They can't keep their schedule. You know, things along those lines. So the thing that I really want to drive home here is I don't think that there is a good or a bad or right or a wrong about these things. What I'm trying to drive home is there's difference. And, you know, when you think about who are you in relationships with, friends with, it's people who share characteristics, right? Who do you live near? Things along those lines. It's people who share your personality characteristics. So the point being is, if, you know, let's take conscientiousness versus openness to experience as it relates to residential decisions. So in terms of a residential decision, if you're open to experience, where do you want to live? Do you want to live in the suburbs, you know, where, you know, the lawns are well kept and, you know, no. You know, where, you know, church is the sort of center of very tradition-minded institution like organized religion. That wouldn't be your thing, but if you score high in conscientiousness, that's perfect. You know, that's exactly where you want to be. But if you're open to experience, you know, you probably want to live near the Thai restaurants with the edgy art openings and, you know, all of that kind of thing. And this is the thing, you know, when my dad and when you guys were growing up, we lived on the same block with people, you know, who had different political leanings. And now, you know, where I'm trying to go with this is, maybe we don't anymore, and this is one of the reasons that we just simply don't get each other. So what Jonathan and I have tried to do is talk not about, you know, psychology so much or biology or physiology or genetics or anything like that. We try to come up, we use a concept that we call a worldview. And based on these things that are deep down and inside of us, you know, the sort of political manifestation of this is what we think of as a worldview, you know. So, you know, the startle and the gag, that probably suggests people who are warier. It's not bad to be wary. It's just that the people who have a strong startle reflex, strong gag reflex, are probably really, you know, warier. And, you know, there are certain things that seem to go together with that. You like hierarchy, you know, order, you know, things that, you know, sort of fit together. That's the best way in that view to get work done. You embrace traditions because those traditions are tried and true. You have a tendency to see the world maybe in us versus them terms because them is a threat to the existing traditions and the way things are done, and maybe things are going to be different and not as good if things are challenged in that way. So there's a notion of wariness of change, a wariness of threats. And you can see where in certain times, this is, you know, and probably for most of human history, this is a good thing to have, right? You know, if there's a tiger who's waiting to eat you, being wary, not a bad idea. If there is a tribe, you know, that looks a little bit different from you and so forth, that's dangerous, you want to be able to understand and see, you know, those types of differences and be able to act on them. Then the other side of this divide we label fluid, you know, so the fixture, you know, on the one end, fluid or on the other. These folks are folks who tend to actually, you know, be into new experiences, traditions not particularly important to them. And it's not even that they are okay with difference, they love it. They're turned on by differences in culture, or so the notion of immigration, bring more. This is something that we're actually enthusiastic about. But where I'm going with this is, if you're on the other side of that divide, you don't get it. You know, that could be a threat. You know, whereas if you're on the fluid side, you're like, no, this is terrific. This is going to make us better. So the notion of social change is, you know, what's at stake. We see this in our everyday lives. You know, the best way to deal with certain political problems, I think you can fit into this framework. You know, I've kind of mentioned immigration, race relations, contestation about, say, sexual orientation. All of these things, I think, fit very neatly onto the fixed fluid divide. And again, this is something I want to get back to. Maybe I'll have a little time to touch on this. But what I want to say is that if these types of issues are not the important issues of the day, then this worldview doesn't matter. That means, you know, there'll be a lot of fixed people in the Republican Party and fixed people in the Democratic Party and vice versa. That's how it used to be. But because of the issues that have become important over the years, we've ended up sorting ourselves out into these two camps that we don't get each other. So if you were to measure this, you know, so I'm a survey researcher. I mean, I can make all of these, assertions. But how would you measure it? You know, you can't ask somebody, well, is your worldview fixed? What are you talking about? I have no idea what that even means. You have to, you know, find ways that allow you to get a sense of on which side of the divide people are. And it turns out the best way to do it is by asking them questions about desirable qualities in children. It's about as universal a thing as you can imagine, right? Children. None of us want bad children. And as somebody who has two kind of teenage children, I want all eight of these things. I want my kids to be independent, but also to respect me. I want them to be self-reliant, sure, but I want them to be obedient too, especially last week, oh my God. I want them to be considerate, but I also want them to be well-behaved and curious and have good manners. But what if we make you choose? Which are the ones that you choose? And it turns out that, and I'll give you some evidence in just a moment, but if you choose the fixed responses, you're overwhelmingly Republican and unlikely to approve of President Obama, very strongly likely to support Donald Trump specifically. And so forth. If you choose the fluid responses, your political hero is Barack Obama. You actually don't so much like Hillary Clinton. If you're on the fluid part of things, you actually tended to support Bernie Sanders in this this recent election, which I find a little bit puzzling, but we can talk a little bit about that. But what I'm saying is, this really works. But let's talk about that for a minute. Why would this work? What is it about child rearing that reveals something about who people are deep down inside? And let me point out that these are just principles. It might not be that people actually parent this way. It's just what they believe, okay? So it could be, you know, someone could choose all the fluid responses and, you know, still, you know, be not particularly open in their actual parenting, but it's probably pretty similar. So what do you guys think? I mean, are you guys sitting there thinking this is crazy? you guys are thinking this is crazy. You've been thinking for the last 25 minutes, all of these things Hetherington's talking about. He's nuts. Well, how about this? This in the social sciences we call a strong relationship. So what this shows is Barack Obama's approval rating, depending upon how many fixed responses you provided to the worldview question. So if you provided zero, you know, you're pretty certain to support Obama. Now again, we didn't mention anything about parties. We didn't mention anything about ideology. We simply asked them about parenting, about kids. One, you know, it drops a little bit. And when you get up to four, nobody supports Obama, you know, who provides the four fixed worldview parenting items. Just to give you a sense of it, you know, we have, and it gives you a sense of just how highly correlated this measure of worldview is with party. You know, Obama's not doing so badly in terms of approval rating. He was a lot like Ronald Reagan was at the end of his presidency. But the gap between Republicans and Democrats in approval ratings, it's never been this wide ever before. You know, 90% of Democrats, 10% of Republicans approved of the job. Last I checked, actually, he's doing the same job. You know, it's just that we think of it so differently. Is that because of his race? I think no, although I think that's part of it. So one of the things that is true is that we've been seeing an increase in the polarization between Republicans and Democrats' approval of presidents building for a while. So the person whose the polarization was second greatest for was George W. Bush. And the one, you know, who was, you know, next closest was Bill Clinton, you know, so it's just been building over time. But one of the things that we are seeing in the research is that people's racial attitudes are becoming, well, during Obama's presidency, are becoming much, much more important in explaining people's political opinions. And especially about things that they didn't used to be about. Okay, so I'll give you a couple of examples. One of them is about politics, and one of them is nonsense, but it's really interesting. Okay, so how about the one about politics? So Bill Clinton in 1994, you know, attempted to pass a comprehensive health care law. Of course, it failed miserably. People's attitudes, racial attitudes, were not connected to their opinions about health care in 1994. In 2010, of course, Barack Obama did the same thing. And those opinions on race were highly related to their opinions about healthcare. So that suggests that the race of the president may well be important in this. So, and in another example, someone did this sort of clever experiment. Speaking of dogs, does anybody know what kind of a dog the Obamas have, Bo? It's a Portuguese water hound, right? Well, it turns out that there was another Portuguese water hound owned by another Democrat. Ted Kennedy had a Portuguese water hound. So in an experiment, a researcher told people that in one case it was Barack Obama's dog, Bo, and showed a picture, showed exactly the same picture to another half sample of people. And you said it was Ted Kennedy's dog. I mean, you know, they're both Portuguese water hounds. I mean, how would you tell the difference between Bo and Skipper or whatever? But it turned out when it was Bo Obama, people's racial attitudes were highly related to their evaluations of a dog, but not with Ted Kennedy's.
Just thinking that Obama's low 50s may not sound like too much to too many people, but that's about as high, I believe, as he's been. Mm-hmm. And given that, I think he's been in the 40s.
Most of the time.
Presidency. Mm-hmm. But I just wonder if maybe people, a lot of people, are thinking, are comparing, contrasting Obama to what we have now.
So great question, and great, actually more of an observation, but it's a right one. Obama's approval ratings have mostly been in the 40s, as you pointed out. But why have they increased into the 50s? And they keep going up. And I think it's, as you suggested, and it's in, they're looking at Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump and thinking, can we have another year of Obama? You know, we take that right now. You know, it might not be ideal, but it might be better than what we got here. So I think that's a really important thing. So this worldview, you know, again, it's also very predictive of people's voting behavior. This is from 2012. One of these lines is the percentage of people who said they voted for the Republican Senate candidate in their state, the Republican presidential candidate, Mitt Romney, or the Republican House candidate. And if you had zero, you know, there's almost no chance that you voted for the Republican, you know, low percentages. And of course, you know, about 70% if you have the four, you know, sort of fixed things. And again, we're talking about parenting preferences. We didn't, you know, mention Republican or Democrat or anything like that. It's just that these things work. So, you know, what a lot of people wonder is, how did Donald Trump end up, you know, getting the nomination? So my dad is an old establishment Republican guy. You know, he worked for a string of Republican governors in Pennsylvania. He was the press secretary for Hugh Scott. Scott was the minority leader of the Senate, the Republican leader of the Senate during the Watergate years. My dad's candidate of choice was John Kasich, and not just because he looks like me. You know, although it's pretty obvious. I actually oddly had somebody stop me in the New Orleans airport, my bag person, or the person who I gave my bag to at the counter in Southwest, and I gave him my ID and he looked at me and he said, "You're not Marc Hetherington, you're the governor of Ohio." And I was like, that's pretty good, I like that. And so I'm gonna embrace it for the rest of my life. But dad is so dismayed, and you know, if it wasn't gonna be John Kasich, he would have loved Jeb Bush, and he would have loved Scott Walker. He could have lived with Marco Rubio, although he wishes that, you know, he was old enough to shave or, you know, whatever. You know, so in that regard. But like, how did the Republicans come up with Trump? And it turns out that it's this worldview, you know, that was very central to it. You know, people who score very high, and now that is much of the Republican base, high in this fixed worldview, they love this notion of building a wall, you know, between the US and Mexico. And just keep in mind, you know, after Mitt Romney lost in 2012, Republicans wrote what they called an autopsy on the election. And the idea was, what did we learn that we need to change? And the first thing on that list was we needed to reach out to Latino voters because it is a growing block of voters. It's the largest minority in the country these days. And the birth rates are relatively higher. And you know, when you think about the country as a whole, and again, this is something that I think is also about Trump's appeal. Under the age of 5, a majority of people in the United States are non-white, okay? So Republicans are gonna need to reach out, and you know, at the highest levels of the party, that's what they think. So Donald Trump shows up on the scene, and what's the first thing he says when he makes his announcement? You know, he calls people coming from Mexico rapists and thieves and things along those lines. And establishment Republicans cringe. They don't want that because they know that that's a loser in the long run. But what does the crowd do? What does the base do? The base cheers. You know, a little bit later on in the campaign season, you know, of course, everybody's concerned about terrorism, right? I mean, it's definitely, you know, something that's of concern. Trump, though, of course, takes it a step farther. You know, I'm going to ban all Muslims from coming into the country. Now, Mitch McConnell, you know, who is, you know, as establishment as any establishment Republican has ever been, says, wait a minute, you know, we can't do that. This is ridiculous. But Trump's numbers continue to go up after he says that, not down. And in a sense, they've lost control of, you know, this sort of base of voters who's very wary, you know, is going to be very aggressive towards these groups that are not like them, and so forth, right? So Trump found, you know, this sort of moment in time when people were particularly uneasy, But he also found this moment in time where the Republican Party had evolved in such a way that people with a fixed worldview weren't split between Republicans and Democrats like they were in the 90s and in the 80s and in the 70s. And probably in the 60s, there were more fixed worldview people in the Democratic Party than in the Republican Party. But now this base is very fixed worldview, very concerned. And you know, if you contrasted the two conventions, I mean, you know, you would think that you were living in two different countries. You know, the Republican convention was very focused on what was wrong, you know, how the country was falling apart, and the Democratic convention told a very, you know, sort of different story. But it's this base of people with a fixed worldview that are concerned about these changes that are taking place. They're happening at breakneck pace. It's very unsettling. And this is, you know, of course, where Trump, you know, sort of fits in. So where I really want to go to, though, is how this not, I mean, Trump is, you know, he's going to turn out to be someone who I think will look back in 15 or 20 years and go, what? How did that happen? Okay? But what's going to be with us is the things that are now connected to the parties. So what I want to, you know, sort of highlight to you guys is just how raw and strong the negative feelings have become. So these are based on data that have been collected by the American National Election Study, which is the major survey organization for academics, all the way back to the 1950s. They've been asking these questions called feeling thermometers since the 1970s. No lie, they actually get out a thermometer and they show it to you. It's got, you know, at the bottom is zero, at the top is 100, and they ask you about people and about groups and about all sorts of different things. And if you have, and you can place yourself anywhere between zero and 100. The only instructions you get is if you really love the group, you know, like as much as you can love anything, it's 100. If you hate the group, it's zero. And if you're indifferent, it's 50. But you can pick anywhere in between 100 and 50. And what I've traced at the top, and the blue lines are the attitudes that Democrats express, and the red lines are the ones that Republicans express. And the solid lines are how they feel about their own party, and the broken lines are how they feel about the other party. And of course, you can see, we don't care, we don't love our own side any more now than we did when Jimmy Carter was president. I mean, it's just, you know, it's just how it is. You know, these are our guys. We don't love them anymore in this polarized time. But what we do is we hate the other side. But I mean, you know, these numbers, 20, 28 and 26, what does that mean? Well, just to put it into some context, one of the groups that they ask about is atheists. Republicans like atheists more than they like the Democratic Party. One of the questions that they ask about, or one of the groups that they identify is Christian fundamentalists. You know, generally speaking, Democrats bugaboo on, you know, certain issues as Christian fundamentalists. Democrats like Christian fundamentalists way more than they like the Republican Party. And both sides like illegal immigrants. Now the question said, or the question is about illegal immigrants. They use the word illegal. It's not just immigrants, but illegal immigrants. They get about a 40. And you know, we get Lambeau Field in December as it relates to the other parties. So this is really cold. There's no groups out there that Republicans dislike more than the Democratic Party and Democrats dislike more than the Republican Party. You'd have to go back to like the 70s where, you know, black militants and people who participate in riots were questions that they asked, were groups that they asked about, to find groups that are more unpopular than the parties are these days. I think this drives it home too. Partisan intermarriage. You know, we used to be concerned about marrying across religious denominations or racial denominations. Back in 1960, these, you know, political scientists, Allman and Verba, asked the question, you know, how would you feel? Would you be displeased if your son or daughter married someone from the opposite party? Almost nobody said yes. But a group of scholars did this in 2010. They repeated the survey question. 49% of Republicans would be unhappy to see their child marry a Democrat, and a third of Democrats would be unhappy if their child married a Republican. This suggests like a chasm, you know, between us not just like political disagreements. I mean, this is real dislike, you know, viewing the other side as broken, as evil. You know, the survey question about whether you view the other side as a threat to the nation used to be a fringe answer. 10% of people would say that. Now close to 50% of partisans say the other party would be a threat, you know, to the safety of the country. So, you know, we end up with this, you know, sort of world where, I mean, you know, you guys, when's the last time we saw stuff like this? You know, in 1968, I suspect, you know, the Chicago Convention, that's been a long time, you know, that we've seen rallies like this. I mean, just look at the anger on this fellow's face. I mean, that is a person who doesn't like the other side very much. This woman got punched out. She was protesting outside of a Trump rally and got punched out by a person who attended the rally. She's either, I can't remember if she's 68 or 69. She wouldn't have been as badly hurt as she was, except for that she fell on her oxygen tank. Yes, she was on oxygen. You know, so it just kind of gives you the sense about, you know, what's going on here. And, you know, I'm not gonna go through this now just because, you know, it's, you know, something that I think applies less, you know, to your generation and more to my students. But one of the things I wanna make clear, you know, to people is, you know, one of the things that I think is really important is not to just give a depressing talk about how divided we are, especially when there are kids in the audience. And, you know, I really encourage them, you know, to think about, you know, how they can be the solution, you know, at some point, because I think the solution to this problem is probably generational. You know, at some point a new generation has to come along and say, you know, we're going to rise above these, you know, these differences that we have, you know, with the sort of petty back and forth that happens in Congress all of the time. So the clips that I show are, you know, from Obama's, the first one is Obama's speech just before the 2008 voting started in Manassas, Virginia, where he tells the story about a woman who was at one of the early Iowa gatherings, and she started a chant. She apparently always did at these things. Where she would say, you know, fired up, and, you know, people would say back to her, ready to go. And Obama closes that speech, you know, by saying, you know, that a single voice can change a room can change a city can change a state can change a country can change the world. And that's, I think, something that's really important for us, and especially for young people, to keep in mind. The other thing that I show them is, I don't know if you guys are sports fans, I'm an enormous sports fan. The ESPN did this thing this year, maybe last, I think it was last year, on 9/11. And it's called First Pitch. And it's about how George Bush, you know, in comforting a nation after 9/11, goes to game three of the World Series. The first two games were in Arizona. Game three was in New York. And he goes out, you know, of course, in the Bronx, you know, in the heart of Blue America, crowd goes crazy for him as he goes down to the mound. He throws a strike. I mean, he really throws a strike. And a lot of this story, you know, was about how nervous he was. He said it was by far the most nervous moment of his presidency, was walking out to the mound. And he had bounced one at a Brewers game earlier on in the season. But the idea is that, you know, in these moments, we can come together. It's not impossible, you know, for us to come together. And boy, you know, did the country come together, you know, during, you know, that particular moment in time. And I tell a story about the moon landing, which of course we all lived through. So I don't have to do that. But you know, I just think, you know, this is, you know, such a terrific image to end on. You know, again, it's not that we can't overcome these differences. I mean, you know, there's the former president and the beloved first lady, you know, really sharing a serious moment together. I'm sure they were bitter rivals, you know, a few years before. And yet, you know, it's possible. Anyway, I try to inspire the students that they're the, you know, sort of answer to this, that they need to drive us to the light. And so there's that. Okay, so that's you know, that's my talk. I'm sticking to it. but I'm happy to answer any questions. You know, if you guys, you know, and it doesn't have to be about the talk either. I mean, we can just talk about politics, where things stand in this particular race. We haven't really, you know, I didn't talk so much about that. You know, what I'm, you know, really interested by is, you know, just how, like, what we're divided over. That's what my research is. But I think it's relevant to why we got the candidates that we got and so forth. So what can I answer for you guys?
Scott Adams, that writes Gilbert, was on the Bill Maher show several weeks ago, maybe several months ago. And one of the things he said, he was decrying, or they were decrying, what made Trump as popular as he is, and what his thesis was that people forget what you say, but they remember how it made you feel. And he said the thing that's dangerous about Trump is if he buys into the anger, then it makes them feel powerful, just as you're showing us this, and it makes us feel patriotic, and it makes us feel we can do more. But it's that same visceral thing that makes it dangerous when it's the other way.
So the question, I'm supposed to repeat the questions for the recording. So the question is about how, in a relative sense, important what people say is versus how it makes them feel. And I think that's exactly right. You know, politics is something that for most people, most Americans, most of the time, does not consume a lot of their thought. So just to put, you know, that into some perspective, think about this. What percentage of Americans can name all nine members, well, when nine were on the court, on the Supreme Court, versus how many can name all nine of their favorite baseball team's players? You know, way more can do the baseball team, you know, than can do the Supreme Court. So what happens when we don't care very much about something, you know, when it's, you know, just, well, we reason about it at a very peripheral level. We don't think in political psychology, we talk about peripheral root processing. What that means is we let our feelings guide us, as opposed to central root processing is where we let our brains guide us. And when we don't care about things, we just go with the feelings. And you know, this is, I think, important as it relates to Trump on one level or another. But it's also important in all sorts of ways. So one of the things that I didn't show, but I think is really interesting, is, you know, you guys would agree, there's one economy, right? I mean, there's just one economy. But Republicans and Democrats see it completely differently. There is a 50 percentage point gap between Republicans and Democrats in their assessment of whether it's getting better, getting worse, or staying the same. Of course, Democrats are 50 percentage points more likely to say it's getting better. Republicans, 50 percentage points more likely to say it's getting worse. There's just one economy. There's a right answer to that question. But again, it's about our feelings. You know, if we're Republicans, we don't want to see it as good. And I'm not saying Republicans are bad for that. Democrats felt the same way when George Bush was president. You know, is the country getting stronger? No, if you're a Democrat, but yes, if you're a Republican. So again, these feelings intervene on objective truths, realities. You know, people wonder, well, why won't people, you know, when Trump does these sort of outlandish things at times, says these outlandish things, why don't they punish him for it? You know, John McCain, you know, he's a coward. You know, I don't like, you know, people who got captured, you know, or whatever. That would kill, you know, any candidate,
anybody else.
But, you know, it's feelings. You know, you just filter that out. You just say,
It's like for all those people who didn't have anyone speaking for them, it's bravado. There is somebody that's going to speak for us, and that's that core.
Yes.
And it's not going to change.
Well, it's going to be really interesting. But let's speak to, you know, as it relates to the future. I'll get to a couple of observations that I have about that, because I feel like we might be right on the verge of a big change in American politics. I might be wrong. In fact, just ask my wife, Suzanne, I'm almost always wrong. But in this case, I might be right. And sometimes, you know, I am. But we'll talk about that in a little bit. Yeah.
Well, with what she said, do you think that Republicans and Democrats, or in their real worldview, have vastly different definitions of what corruption is?
Vastly different definitions of what corruption is. Now, this is a really interesting question. So what? Okay, so the question, again, for the camera, is do people on the right and left have different definitions of corruption? Let me follow that up before I answer with a, do you think they do, and what do you have in mind? Well, okay, if you don't, because I was wondering if you had something specific in mind.
I think they do.
Yeah, I feel like that might be the case. One thing that's really, really important to keep in mind, though, as it relates at least to public corruption, government, you know, corruption, everybody hates the government. I mean, you know, right, left, center, I mean, you know, nobody has anything nice to say about the government in Washington. And it's one of, I think, the most consequential changes that's taken place over the last 50 or 60 years.
Actually, I do have something.
Okay, give it, tell me. I knew if I stalled enough.
The
what?
The tax loophole question.
Oh, okay, so, Trump is smart for not paying taxes.
Or just that fact that that got passed as an add-on to the tax legislation.
I see. So the corruption that
and
maybe...
And not necessarily a particular person, but the whole Congress.
Yeah, sure.
I mean,
okay,
we're
so,
all equally...
The lobbyists, yeah, you were talking about all the dark money, you know. So I think people who are on the political left are going to be much more concerned about the corruption that money causes. I think people on the right are a little less concerned about, you know, those types of things. I think the people who are on the right might be more concerned about the waste that takes place, you know, in government, the inefficiencies, you know, and things along those lines. That's just my observation, but beyond, you know, that just conjecture, what I will say is, you know, government's reputation is so bad on both sides that, you know, and Congress has been so ineffective for so long now that, you know, people's trust in that institution in particular is below 10% oftentimes these days. So, if Republicans and Democrats can agree on anything, it's how bad the Congress is. You know, that specifically. Yes, sir.
Maybe it's represents the bias on my part. But it seems to me like the more fluid perspective is correlatable with creativity. Mm-hmm. And the extent that we have segregated ourselves state by state in that way, mm-hmm. the states being more of the fluidity, would be more creative, mm-hmm. and they typically are wealthier. I wonder if the whole thing goes together, whether the state would, and that of course then attract the money and the creativity, and attract more for the younger people in particular, but for opportunities. I wonder whether we're somehow dividing the nation in an economic way based on these personality traits.
Boy, oh boy. So, you know, there's a really important book written a little while ago by a guy named Andy Gelman called Red State, Blue State, Rich State, Poor State. And all the, you know, paradoxically, because we think of Republicans as being the high income party, paradoxically, all of the richest 10 states, with maybe one exception, are Democratic states. And all of the poorest 10 states, with no exception, are red states. And you know, you think about, you know, these places. So, you know, California, of course, San Francisco, Los Angeles. You know, two hubs of what we would call creativity. And think about, like, you know, Virginia used to be a really dark red state. In fact, Virginia, you know, but now is a blue state, or increasingly blue. Why is that? You know, it's because of, you know, the fast-growing DC suburbs where there are a lot of
More creativity.
Well, and, you know, more tech, you know, more of those things. North Carolina is on the verge of flipping. Trump could lose a lot of states, but even if it remained relatively close, he still could lose that. Why would that be? Well, the research triangle, which again is sort of a tech area, and again, there's creativity, but then but there's another side of business too, and of course that is sort of efficiency and managerial acumen, which tends to be better in among people who have a more sort of fixed worldview. But and this allows me actually maybe to answer this question about where I think the country is going, and that is this. What was the Sanders people's big beef about Hillary Clinton? She was the senator from Wall Street. She gave these speeches to Goldman Sachs and stuff like that. Well, where do you think business is, in this election? Of course, business is usually a stalwart Republican group, right? I mean, that's what we always think about, the sort of country club Republican, that's the world my dad, sort of occupies. How do you think these folks feel about Trump? They can't stand him. I'm sorry?
They're not supporting Trump at all.
I know. Sort of big, CEO types, from major corporations. And what do they, they find Trump unpredictable. What does business want? They want predictable. They want an environment they know what they're going to get tomorrow. When I was in London, one of the groups I talked to was this business group. They're like bank executives from like Lloyd's and like big places. they're terrified of a Trump victory. Now, business also has a investment in business, right? And when you run a business, you want a lot of customers. If a majority of kids under the age of 5 are non-white, and you have a party that is headed by Donald Trump, who wants to build a wall, between the U.S. and Mexico, who has a hard time admitting that the president was born in the United States, things along those lines, that's not good for business. Young people don't like that stuff. So between youth and the changing demographics of the country, Hillary Clinton is kind of a nice bridge for sort of big capital to find its way sort of in the more democratic direction. She's the senator who represented Wall Street after all. I think that they'll be just fine with that. So this could be sort of step along the road. But towards the Democratic Party that I think a lot of people who are Democrats now aren't going to be real satisfied by. It's going to be a much more economically conservative Democratic Party. It'll still be a very culturally liberal Democratic Party because the economic elites tend to be socially, quite liberal, if they care, about social issues at all. And you'll end up with a Republican Party that's socially conservative. And of course, the focus of the Trump campaign has been the sort of suffering working class whites, who are really hurting, in this country. We see mortality rates of whites between the ages of 40 and 55 going through the roof. But among whites only. There's despair in these communities. There's alcoholism, especially among women. There's opioid abuse. There's suicide in these places that is remarkable. But and this has been a group that traditionally the Democratic Party has been the salve for. After this election, it's going to be hard for the Democrats to feel real positively towards this group. So I think that we may be on the verge of a kind of maybe a reorganization of interests here along the lines that you're kind of getting at.
Where do you think the Republican Party goes after the election, assuming Trump wins?
This is a great question. Where will the Republican Party go after this, if Trump, I'm going to go out on a limb here now that Hillary Clinton in the last poll that I saw is up 14, I think he's going to lose. So let's say that happens. But here's the thing. People keep talking about the Republican Party that is in disarray, it's in collapse. That's only true at the presidential level. You know, the Republican Party has never been in better shape in state legislatures and governorships since 1924. They're in real trouble as a national party because of the stance that it's taken as it relates to minorities in particular. So that's a killer in a national election where, you know, turnout is 60% or something along those lines. But, you know, I bet if we had this conversation in 2008 when it looked like Barack Obama was going to, you know, beat John McCain and beat him, you know, pretty handily, he ended up winning by about 7, we could have had the same kind of conversation. And what happened in 2010? The Republicans swept back into power in the House and in the Senate. In 2012, Obama won again. And what happened in 2014? So we have this weird thing where we have two different electorates. We have a presidential year electorate, and we have an off-year electorate. We have roughly 60% turnout in the presidential year. We have roughly 35 to 40% of turnout in the off years, in the congressional years. And of course, a lot of state houses, the state governorships are decided in election years that are in the off years, not in the presidential year. So what does the Republican Party do? Usually for a party to change, it's got to get killed. You know, when did the Democrats change? It was after, you know, after McGovern and Mondale and Dukakis. And then, you know, they were like, maybe we're not in step with the rest of the country, and we got Clinton. You know, and, you know, he's got his problems, but, you know, he was more moderate, you know. It took beatings over a long period of time, you know, to change. But the Republicans, they might take a beating in the presidential year this year, and it has the potential to affect, you know, voting in the Senate and voting in the House. But they'll be back in 2018. And, you know, here's the thing. Let's play this forecast out a little bit. I'll ask you. Do you think that if, let's say the Democrats win the Senate, which I think is a high probability, and let's say they even pull off a great upset because of all of this craziness and win the House, do you think that Congress will be really productive in the next 2 years under a Hillary Clinton presidency?
Well, the way you're asking me, I'd say no, but I actually think that it can be productive with the Democrats. I don't know why.
So here's the, okay, so this is a great question. All right, so why wouldn't it be? Well, because the norms in the Senate have changed. The norms in the Senate used to be that the filibuster was almost never threatened or invoked. Just to put it into some perspective, there were, in the 1960s, before, you know, some rules changes took place, you'd get 3, 2, 4 filibusters a session, an entire 2-year session. Now, every question that comes before the Senate, except for should we name a bridge after you, or something like that, gets filibustered, okay? Every question. And so, and we don't have a filibuster, but what happens is that the minority party requires the majority party to show that they could bring debate to a halt if they filibustered. That requires 60 votes. Now, the Democrats aren't going to have 60 votes. You know, they're going to have 51, maybe 52. That would mean 8 or 9 Republicans crossing over. They're not going to do that. And, you know, and what if the Republicans compromise with the Democrats? Who would get the credit? Would the Republicans get it? No. Let's say the gridlock continues. Are the Republicans going to get blamed for that? No. It's going to be, you know, the Democrats and Hillary Clinton. So just, you know, that could sound like conjecture, but let's go back to Mitch McConnell. Mitch McConnell is the, what's his job now? Majority leader. 8 years ago, what was his job? Minority leader. You know, by putting a stop to the Democrats' agenda, he went from having 40 seats to 54 seats. That's a pretty good payoff for gridlock. I feel like our government's broken. I mean, you know, and our government is broken. It's no longer majoritarian. The incentives are there to make it not work. And it's, you know, and again, there used to be norms. Like, it didn't used to be rules that kept the country going. It was norms. But now the norms are being violated. And I should add, in the last 3 years of the Bush presidency, the Democrats did exactly that to the Bush agenda. It's not just, you know, Mitch McConnell is, you know, some evil guy. Harry Reid did the same thing when he was leader, minority leader. Yeah.
Well, I think it's people. Mm-hmm.
Okay, so this is a good question. So the fixed people value good manners. They value, but are they not actually, you know, sort of demonstrating it? But do they, here's the question, you know, you have good manners for people who deserve it. Maybe, but you know, what if the other side, what if they're evil? You know, what if they're bad people? But we tend to think this about our opponents, you know. You know, why don't we compromise? Well, I mean, how many compromises do you guys make with the devil? I mean, you know, but that's what it's kind of gotten to be like. You know, how mannerly would you? You know, there's one of my students, a wonderful student who I have working on her PhD right now that I and Larry Bartels are directing. She's doing this work on conspiracy theories or rumors. And there's a new rumor about, the last one was that Hillary Clinton was able to recover seemingly from her fainting spell so quickly because she had a body double. And a fair percentage of people believe it when asked. There's a big reporting going out now, according to Kerry, I don't know whether this is true or not, that Clinton and Obama may be demons. Seriously. They're demons. So who knew? They're what? Yeah, they're flawed like everybody. And this is the thing. And you know, so I'll tell another story because I'm in a storytelling mood. I'm punchy from coming back from London. But you know, when my dad worked in the Senate, he tells these stories. That I think are really instructive about how the process can work if the norms, you know, are different. So the Republicans were never going to take the majority in the Senate during that time, even though Nixon was winning, you know, big, you know, landslide victories. They were trailing by 100 seats in the House and plenty in the Senate as well. So if you don't have a chance to win the next election, then you do compromise because, you know, then you can get something. You know, if you don't compromise, then you get nothing. Under circumstances like that, you do. So Hugh Scott, my dad's boss, the Republican leader, every single week that the Senate was in session, Dad says that at least staff between the two senators, or maybe the senators themselves, would meet in the Senate dining room at the beginning of the week and chart what the calendar was going to be like for the Senate that week. Can you imagine Harry Reid and Mitch McConnell getting together to do that? It would be great, but I don't think they talk, and I don't think their staffs talk. But that's the way that norms were different back then. Mm-hmm. You know, I think Mansfield, you know, the old Democratic leader, was a really remarkable guy. You know, so in 1964, when Goldwater ran, and the Democrats just killed him. You know, there may have been fewer than 35 Republican members at that point. Mansfield thought it was very important not to embarrass the Republicans, but rather to make them feel like they were still part of the body, you know, still part of the Senate, and found ways to reach out to them, even though they had been completely disgraced in this last election. Do you think that would happen these days? No chance. They'd stick it to them as hard as they could because they had got it stuck to them last time. And that's, I think, where the problem, you know, is.
I think what we're missing is statesmen. There are, and there's just nobody waiting in the wings that appears. Well, I don't know, maybe those young men from Texas, the Hispanic guys.
Who knows, but it just doesn't feel like it.
There's just nobody.
So the question is, you know, where are the statesmen? You know, where are the sort of political greats? You know, where is, you know, Franklin Roosevelt or Abraham Lincoln or Thomas Jefferson? And I think a big question, you know, this gets back to one of the things that I was talking about before. Who runs? You know, who wants to go through this meat grinder, you know, on one level or another? Do the best and the brightest, you know, really do this? I mean, Hillary Clinton, I think, is a really interesting character in certain ways, but not because of her statespersonship, but rather because she sits down and works really hard, I think, every day. I mean, I have, you know, complete faith in her willingness to sit down across from the other side and at least give it a try. You know, I think Obama, frankly, gave up on that. I think he had had it. Hillary Clinton must have, over her 30 or 40 or 50 years in 40 years in public life, I mean, just the skin of a lizard. I mean, it has to be so thick. And that's what it requires, you know, I think, just to go to work. Now, is that inspiring? You know, is that the kind of thing that, you know, kids are like, let's do minor things together? That's not what kids get excited about. But that might be in this environment what's required. And that's what I think business people, you know, could get behind. Incremental changes that make the system work a little bit better. You know, things along those lines. But, you know, I'd take this notion about statesmen, you know, in a slightly different direction, too. You know, I agree, you know, we don't see any of this on the horizon. Obama was this, you know, incredibly inspiring figure, you know, but the actual business of government, you know, I think robbed a lot of, you know, that as time went by. But I mean, like, you know, where are heroes anywhere, you know, in our, you know, sort of public life? You know, who's the... You know, and can you be, you know, the equivalent of a, you know, a Joe DiMaggio or a Ted Williams, or, you know, do we just know all of the flaws of these people, which were ample? You know, if folks were looking in the 1940s, they would have learned them about, you know, the DiMaggios and Williamses too. Maybe it's just society has changed, you know, in ways that makes this impossible. And one last thing, what's the payoff for statesmanship? I mean, you got to have a partner. And then, you know, John Boehner, you know, he and Obama, it sounds like, reached some agreements, and then Boehner had to go back to his caucus, and his caucus said, I'm not with you. So it's tough. Yeah.
I think society is changing, and that's why I guess I'm optimistic, and I think if Hillary does get in there, that Bernie Sanders and Elizabeth Warren will really take over the Senate and start putting a lot of their ideas in. And breaking up big business and taking the United.
Well, it'll be interesting to see on issues that involve, you know, big redistributions of income. So Hillary is going to win this election with a lot of support from major banks and, you know, stuff like that. Why wasn't Elizabeth Warren her running mate? She's not with her.
She
doesn't agree with her
the
on
best person.
Well, no, but I mean, I think she doesn't agree with her on policy. You know, I think she could have been a really useful running mate in a lot of ways to shore up that, you know, sort of liberal wing of the party. I really think that the Democrats are moving away from, you know, that, you know, sort of old time stuff, you know, in that respect. And, you know, in response to this question, you're going to need 9 Republicans, you know, to move any of that stuff. And you're not going to get 9 Republicans for Bernie Sanders' agenda. You know, it's clear, you know, and kids love it because it, you know, of its clarity and it's revolutionary and stuff like that. But, you know, this moment in time is going to be for the incrementalists, you know, not the revolutionaries, even if, you know, it's an enormous blowout at the presidential level. So the other thing that I would just love to see, too, and this gets at the statesmanship question and the Mike Mansfield thing. I've been talking about this a lot with one of my colleagues. You know, wouldn't it be great if your side won that you just didn't feel the need to spike the ball and do a dance in the end zone, you know, and instead just went to work, you know, and, you know, try to bring the other side in, you know. But we can't help it because I think our feelings about the other side are so raw. We hate them. Love your neighbor.
Love your neighbor as yourself. Mm-hmm. And who's your neighbor? Everybody.
So the observation, which is a great one, you know, as borrowed, you know, from church, you know, the golden rule. I mean, you know, do unto others as you would have them do unto you. But except for maybe in politics, apparently, you know, that seems to be, it would be a great, you know, thing to live. But, you know, but think about how hard this is as a member of Congress. So, you know, just to choose a high-profile person who's been around a long time, let's say Nancy Pelosi. So, you know, if you're Nancy Pelosi and, you know, in the late 90s, the Republicans stuck it to you, you know, as your party, you hated that. So when you get into power, is it easy to say, I'm going to rise above it? No, you stick it to them. And then the Republicans are back in, and then they stick it to her again, and so forth. And that's why I think this change needs to be generational. We need new people, you know, who haven't had it stuck to them, you know, yeah. So recently, you know, because it's human nature, right? You know, especially when you think they're bad people, when you don't see the world in the same way, when we're divided by worldviews the way that we're divided now. Yes, ma'am.
When you had a shorter campaign season, like just 3 weeks, maybe they would make a difference? That you would have less time to yell at each other?
You know, I would have answered that question differently before Donald Trump. Because if we only had 3 weeks of a campaign with him, maybe he'd be president. And I think that, again, I'll echo my dad, lifelong Republican. He thinks that would be terrible and dangerous and, you know, bad for the country and stuff
because
like that.
Why you wouldn't get to know them enough?
Well, I can't remember. I'm still a little jet lagged. One of you all made a reference to feelings. It was you, right? Feelings instead of words. He's a feeling candidate. He's good at that.
TV. He's used TV
exactly.
To his advantage. When he was calling in the Today Show every day,
yeah.
I was saying, all right, why isn't John Kasich calling in? Why isn't Bush calling in?
Yeah.
Why isn't Ted Cruz calling
yeah.
in?
Because he's good at it. And he gets covered because he's a celebrity. So short campaign with somebody like that, I think that's almost made for demagoguery, you know, on one level or another. Our system is so flawed. I mean, you know, this is a terrible way to nominate a president. And just ask any establishment Republican right now, they'll tell you exactly the same thing. This is a terrible way. Because, you know, again, remember, this is a year they should be winning. You know, the economy's not roaring, it's just fine. It's the third year, or third term for a Democrat, potentially. That's hard to get. If the nominee had been, you know, John Kasich or Scott Walker, you know, Bush carries a lot of baggage because of his name. But a conventional Republican, Mitt Romney, they'd win. You know, they would have won. You know, I think, you know, the fundamentals were definitely in their favor.
You know, when you were talking about statesmen, in some way, Romney was a statesman when he came out and said,
This is a really fascinating.
Because he didn't have anything to lose.
I agree. You know, but it's also interesting. I don't know if you follow this at all. But over the weekend, the real condemnation among elected Republicans of all places, other than the swing states, you know, because like the swing state senators who are running for re-election, they're running scared from Trump. But in a deeply, darkly red state, Utah, they came out and gave it to him. You know, all of them disavowed him, except for Orrin Hatch. He still has him. Of course, the thing that ties them together, and Mike Crapo actually in Idaho too, they're Mormon. And, you know, Trump's apparent lack of tolerance of other religions is a real breaking point for faithful Mormons. And, you know, people can point to the fact that, well, you know, Romney was fine getting Trump's money in 2012. Yeah, but so would anybody. You know, I mean, you're not going to send, you know, that check back. But, you know, when he had an opportunity to stand up early on and say, this is a problem, he was the only one doing it.
Yeah.
And I think in retrospect, I think his religious commitments are, you know, maybe central to his willingness to make that stand. I'm not 100% certain of that, but I do think that that may well be the case. You know, when he was talking about banning Muslims from the country, I think Mormons got very, very concerned about, well, you know, we're a religion that's been persecuted for, you know, 100-some years. I mean, I don't want any part of that. What other questions do you guys have?
I got a bizarre speculation.
Okay.
I always imagine a situation where the Republican Party will split like doing now, the left wing and the right wing kind of maybe die. poor ideas and money. The Democratic Party gets strong and splits, and then picks up some of the, and the left, the right side of the Democratic Party, and then pick up some of the leftover Republicans. We end up with two new parties. One's a, would come out of the divided Democratic Party, with a left and a right. It seems like the left is there with Bernie and their people. I can see the center forming in the Democrats, and I can almost see them picking up some disadvantaged Republicans. I mean, there are some Republicans in their vote for Hillary.
Oh, I think that they will in this election.
Maybe that coalition can almost form, particularly if the party itself wins.
Yeah. This is a Democrat's fantasy. Yeah. It could. It is possible. Again, but just let's think about this. You know, one of the things that I think will be a real tension in the Democratic Party, I agree the Republican Party splits are all obvious. But, you know, even though... Like, you know, what, let's say what I forecast about, you know, the sort of more economic conservative business community, you know, comes on, you know, board with the Democrats because the Republicans are just unable to get past this difference thing. Well, how excited are racial minorities and ethnic minorities going to be about a big business run? No. So, you know, maybe all of a sudden that group, you know, thinks, maybe I have more in common with these white working class, you know, folks than it seemed. They might not like me, but you know, again, so I think all of these things are dynamic. There's a push and a pull. So anyway, just for whatever it's worth, the one thing that I think, if we're looking for parallels, you know, I think we might be into a period that is a lot like the early 20th century. The sort of, you know, the electoral map looks almost exactly the same. You know, you remember, you probably don't, I had to go back and revisit this. The Democrats kept renominating the same guy, William Jennings Bryan, for president every time. He ran three times, lost by bigger margins each time. The party just couldn't get it together. And my sense is the Republicans are gonna go through this too, because again, it's hard to break the habit, you know, of relying on the things that they're relying on. So with that said, you know, we could get, you know, a period of Democratic dominance, but it's not going to be a period of Democratic dominance that looks anything like Lyndon Johnson.
Well, I was envisioning, you mentioned the minorities. I thought the Democratic Party could split, and minorities would be left.
Yeah. Well, the one thing that's holding minorities together like they've never held together before is Donald Trump.
Of course.
Yeah. I mean, that'll do it. You know, usually Latinos are split all over the place depending upon what country of origin, you know, the people come from. Not this year. I mean, you know, it's amazing. Well, you guys have been seriously a tremendous audience. Thanks so much for coming out. And if you have questions, you know, please feel free to come say hi.
Bricks. Sturdy, heavy, hard, smooth, rough, narrow, wide, ignored as ordinary, yet formed with ancient skills, bricks offer security without aggression. White to black, rose to cream to gray, touches of purple, magenta, vermilion, the history and moods of earth are revealed by their presence. Used for strength, yet brittle, bricks shed chips when tumbled, but last centuries stack tightly. They stand steady, offer the pleasures of earth, a sense of time, rarely intrude, simply wait for the observer's eye.